One, two. Is that it? That's it.
Yes, it's on now.
Y'all just asking me to talk continually.
Keep talking.
I was about to say something in the opposite direction, but you got me first. Yes, thank you very much. Thank you.
The others. The others are okay.
Something on that day, lest you be kind of be, it may just get away from you. You may have to say, I was going to say something, but we make sure that you say something on your day. Is that reasonable? You know them all because you studied them all. So your Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Logos Sabbath School. Can we close our eyes for a word of prayer? Father, we thank you so much. It is wonderful outside, and we just want to give you praise and honor this morning for waking us up and bringing us here, loving God, with the privilege of ministering to those in internet land, loving God, and television land. We pray, loving God, that your spirit will be in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, everybody, to Logos University. One of the questions that was raised is, why the word Logos? And as we've introduced last week, it's not just a Greek word that means word. The ending actually suggests that it is the word. And of course, everyone wants to have the last word. But as the Adventist tradition, the Bible and the Bible alone is the word. And of course, the Word, which is the words of Jesus Christ, have been studied with the work of the Holy Spirit to impress it upon our minds. Many times our words, and the words of philosophers, the words of scholars, come from the flesh. But we need to submit the flesh, our words, to the Spirit, which impresses Jesus' words upon our hearts. And we believe that from Genesis straight through to Revelation, Jesus has been speaking to a major problem. And that problem is the fallen condition of mankind and also the character of God. And it's the Word that we go to talk about our condition, and it is the Word we go to for fixing our condition. And it's by the Word we get a clear understanding of the character of God, and we can remove the devil's suspicions about that character. Because it's only then that we are healed and treated from our condition. We need to go back to the Word. So Logos University is just that, a university, a study center that does more than just does a topical, superficial looking at this text. We hope to go more than just the literal. We want to go to understanding what it means and also how does it apply to people today in 2020 post-corona. That's specific. So you want to introduce the panel again. Brother Bird, you have something you wanted to share on that?
Yes, Elder. Once we get through with this, sir, it would be wonderful because I know we're going to have soul service. I know it, and I can't wait to get to it. But thank you, Elder, for introducing us again this morning, and you can carry on, Elder.
Yes. So this particular study we're reading from the Seventh-day Adventist Sabbath School lesson, How to Study Scripture. And a question is raised, why are we studying how to study Scripture? It seems like everybody would know how to study Scripture. But because everybody actually studies Scripture differently, we've taken time to study how do we study Scripture and how was the Scripture originally determined to be studied. So we're going to look at this week. The week is the week of May the what?
May the 9th to the 15th. But Elder, before we get into that, we're just going to have a song service.
Yes.
Song service and a few things before that. And then Sister Ashley, you can carry on with that.
Okay.
Tell you, you're excited about getting to
I'm
this.
I'm excited to get going
indeed.
With the Word.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Sister Ashley.
Okay, so we will sing hymn number 612, Onward Christian Soldiers. We'll sing a cappella, so
amen.
Feel free to, panel members, feel free to join in if you'd like.
Yes, indeed.
Onward Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe. Forward into battle, see his banners go. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Verse 2. Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Christians, we are treading where the saints have trod. We are not divided, all one body we, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus
church prevail. This through Christ's own promise that can never fail. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng. Lend with us your voices in the triumph song. Glory, praise, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages men and angels sing. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before.
Amen. Well, good morning, everyone. And we are so delighted that you've joined us again at Lagos University. You know, this is a special university. It has one course, and that course is to study the Word of God. It also only has one textbook. That textbook is the Bible, the Word of God. So indeed, it's easier than regular university where you have various courses. One thing I like about this university and this course is that it chooses to study various things each quarter. That is, every 3 months, there's a different topic to study about the Word of God. As you heard earlier, this quarter, we are studying how to interpret the Bible. That's our main textbook. How we can verify its truth. How we can understand some parts that seem difficult. Today, we're studying language, text, and context. But we studied a number of things about this Bible. So I want you, as I would say, sit back, relax, and enjoy the study. Welcome to Lagos University, and we want to share with you the Word of God.
Amen, Sister DeGraff. This week's text is found in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 26, and it reads, "Take this book of the law and put it beside the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, that it may be there as a witness against you." Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much again for bringing us here today. And as we embark on our Sabbath school, Lagos Sabbath School, loving God, we pray for your presence to be in this place. We also pray for our country, loving God, who is still going through the throes of the coronavirus, loving God. Many have lost loved ones, and we just want to lift them up before you, Father, and pray that your spirit will go alongside those who are suffering, those who are sorrowing, loving God. Many are finding themselves where they've lost jobs, loving God, and we pray that the provisions that they need to take care of their families may be provided, loving God, in whichsoever way you desire. And loving God, we're praying that even as we go through this challenge in our country, not only even throughout the world, we pray that people might look towards you, recognizing, loving God, that your word is true. There is coming a day, Father, where we're going to deal with things that we did not expect to deal with. And yet, your word has given us warning way in advance to let us know that the time is coming very soon that your son will return in the clouds of glory. And so, Father, even as we pray this prayer, loving God, we pray that your spirit again will move in this Sabbath school. Father, even as we introduce our moderator, we pray that you'll fill him with your spirit, loving God, and those on the panel, that we might be right witnesses for you today, that your name might be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mr. Moderator.
Amen. Happy Sabbath again, everyone. Let's start with the root text. This is the text that Dr. Hazel, two theologians and scholars in the Adventist tradition have found is most important for this particular week's study. And it's found in the text of Deuteronomy, chapter 32, verse 46 and 47. Would you mind reading that for us, Ashley? Deuteronomy 32, verse 46 and 47.
And it reads, Elder, and he said to them, set your hearts on all the words which I testify among you today, which you shall command your children to be careful to observe all the words of this law. For it is not a futile thing for you, because it is your life. And by this word, you shall prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to possess.
Yeah, so in that phrase, there is this discussion of set your hearts, fix your mind. And it wasn't just talking about one part of the message. It was a word that lasts for the entire Bible. And not just do it for the sake of academia and just for study. But what was the reason why we need to rightly divide the text? What does it say? What was the reason why we should be setting our hearts on this word?
So that we will live long in the land. Mm-hmm. It's to prolong our days.
And then the next verse talked about not just the land in the wilderness, but also in the land in the Canaan land where they were coming.
Yes, that they were crossing the Jordan to possess.
So the application is studying the word not only protects us as we live through this world that we're living, it gives us guideposts on what we should do and what we should not do, commandments to protect us. In the children of Israel's time, it was dietary laws, there were hygiene laws. But also when they get into the promised land, this will be the principle that will govern their life. Such is with our lives. The Bible is not just for us today to guide us. There are many people who didn't have the instructions of the Bible and their lives have become shipwrecked. But it's also prepare us for the Canaan to come, the eternal life. So studying the word rightly will determine the difference between eternal life and one who dies forever. So that's why we take the word so seriously as Adventists. Well, Ashley, why don't you start us off on Monday's lesson? The question says what?
Sure. The first verse...
Sunday,
yes. The first text that was given was 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17. And the question was, for what purpose was the Bible given to us? So the verses say, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And I'm reading from the NIV translation. So basically, scripture is given so that we can make sure that we are on the right track, so we are understanding what it is that God is wanting to tell us. And understanding the law and the scriptures is important because it equips us for every good work that we are to do. And also, our lives actually depend on it. And we have many other benefits that are derived from the study of God's word, such as the correction and the instruction and equipping us for serving God. But really the overall purpose of God's communication to us is to save us from certain death at the hands of Satan. So the message is so vital because God has resorted to human spokesmen to relay these messages to us through his word.
I would say that, you know, having been in the Bermuda Regiment years ago, this was some years ago now.
You've been in the regiment, Burr?
I was in the regiment.
Are
yes, I was.
Colonel?
I would say that the one thing we understood was that you had to learn how to follow instruction. Instruction was meant not only to save your life, but it was also meant to save the lives of others. And so it was the idea of following those who had commanded you. And so we have a commander in chief, and his name is Jesus Christ. And with the idea that the commander-in-chief gives instructions and the instructions get passed on to those of us who are in lower ranks, and at the end of it, we follow it so that we are victorious, not individually, but also as a group. And so just like the Bible here is profitable for doctrine and for reproof and for correction and instruction and righteousness, it is a way of how we conduct ourselves in this war that we actually live in, this spiritual war that we deal with on a daily and individual basis.
Mr. Graff, when it says correction and reproof, talk to me about that.
Well, as we know, I guess as a parent, I can understand the value of correction. We guide our children. I'll say our children, even in school, as a teacher, you have specific things that you want your children to do. And you have guidelines. We have guidelines. The beautiful thing here is, the word of God is the greatest guideline, even for parents or teachers or anyone. But it's always to make sure that they're doing what is, I'll say, right. Sort of like what the elder just said. You want to ensure that they're following the word. Now, if they don't, you have the consequences. This is what I like about this word. It tells you how to live. It tells you what to do. But if you don't do, here's the consequence. Like if I tell my son, I want you to do thus and so. If you don't do it, you're going to be beaten, let's say. Although that's a bad word nowadays. You're not supposed to do that to your children. But I'm old school, as you know. And there are times when you had to get that strap out and give them a good spanking. I'll use that word. That sounds a little nicer than beating. But it's for reproof, to teach us what we must do if, like in Deuteronomy it says, we're going to prolong those days. Those of us who find ourselves prolonging our days, always find that we're following the word of God. Now, one might say, that ain't true, because look, like let's take health. You mentioned health, and you're a doctor. God says if we follow, there in Deuteronomy again, if we follow his way of eating and exercising, the 8 laws of health, you know what I mean? We won't get any of the diseases that there are in the world today. That in that day, same diseases today. Now, I believe that's true. I really believe that, that God, even if we are, exposed to something, we find that we're better able to control it or to manage it if indeed we follow God's 8 laws. If we don't, what we find, there is the problem and the correction he tells us is there. We'll get these things, we'll die, we'll whatever. And so that correction and reproof is essential for our well-being, but God has given it to us to let us know what we must do if we want to live correctly.
Amen.
And I think also, so we've brought out the points about how the scriptures can prolong our days from a spiritual standpoint, from a physical aspect as well, and also socially. Mm-hmm. And so the Bible teaches mm-hmm. us not only how to treat ourselves, but how to treat others. Mm-hmm. And so how you treat others sometimes affects your daily life. Mm-hmm. And so if you treat others with kindness and gentleness and portray the fruits of the Spirit, mm-hmm. then you are better able to get along with your fellow human beings mm-hmm. and enjoy a longer life.
In fact, could I just add to that? Just a thought came to mind. We don't necessarily have to spend a lot of time, but that whole concept of forgiveness and treating people kindly has a lot. The end result, like there's a verse that says, be kind to everybody, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God Jesus, for Christ's sake, will forgive you. Also, like he says, vengeance is mine, I'll repay. You heap coals of fire on that enemy's head, mm-hmm. and you'll find things will be better. That's the point where he makes, hey, you do what I tell you to do, it's going to be easier. You don't, there's more problems that will occur.
I don't want to miss the opportunity to make it clear that many times the things that happened in the Old Testament in the physical sense were also representative of those that were happening in the spiritual realm. Mm-hmm. And so just like it's speaking here about the fact that God is promising them, if you do these things, then your life will be prolonged physically within the land of Canaan. It's also a spiritual application in the sense that if we do these things, our life will be prolonged eternally in the kingdom of God. And so I don't want us to forget that in many cases, these are examples of spiritual applications that can go forward to the future and in the spiritual realm.
Mm-hmm. Well, Burge, you work in the area of behavioral sciences and the probation services, I believe. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Yeah.
That's correct.
So give me an example of something from the Bible that if some one of those young people who have passed through your hands may have wound up in jail, had they known a principle from the Bible, it could have preserved their life. Is there a principle in the Bible that can be used that could have avoided some of the
problem? Very much so. We can simply look at the 5th commandment, which says to obey your parents. And many of them have come, and we've had conversations about those things, and they can literally tell me, some of them in particular, the younger ones, who will tell me that they were warned beforehand about what they should and should not do, and that the fact that they knew what the right thing was to do is not that they did not know what the right thing was to do. They chose to do something different. And because they chose to do something different, they fell afoul of the law, and then they found themselves coming to see a person like me. Of course, the beautiful thing about it is that we can have conversations and they can mature and choose not to do it again. But the fact is, sometimes, even though we have this counsel from the Word of God, sometimes we don't obey. And when we don't obey, there are consequences, like Sister DeGraff said. So, yes, it happens very often. I see it very often in my line of work. But again, I will say that the beauty of it is that just like God shows mercy and grace, that we have a responsibility ourselves, those of us who are able to minister to people, to actually exercise mercy and grace. Because I have found that what changes a person is not necessarily restrictions. It is love that I find breaks people's heart. It is love that makes them want to do the right thing, because they themselves recognize that there is a greater cause other than just telling them what to do. There's a better reason for why they should do what they do. And once they themselves accept that the concept is right and beneficial to them, they go forward themselves. And we don't have to have that discussion anymore.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I would like to highlight is that we live in a culture and a time when people don't want to hear reproof. Mm-hmm. And the postmoderns, what we call it, or the new generation, X generation, millennial generation, the further we get down, the more self is expressed. It's more of a my way, and you can have your way, but there's not one way. And so the notion of telling someone, giving reproof, is something that's very uncomfortable in this culture.
Yes.
The consequence of not taking instruction and reproof is early death, unnecessary death, sickness and suffering. I mean, if you were to tell a young lady, do not get on an MTV movie wearing scantily clothes, she'll tell you that's my own way of doing things. Mm-hmm. But the consequence might be winding up in relationships that are destructive. But the Bible would have said, the Spirit of Prophets would have said, guard well the heavens and the soul. But it talks about those instructions given by elders in the Bible to protect you. Mm-hmm. So the Bible gives a lot of good advice to even young people today, that if you listen to it, it can avoid you jail, AIDS, premature death, emotional distress, children who don't have fathers. We have a lot of complications in our society because we did not take the instruction, the reproof, mm-hmm. and the counsel from the Bible. Well, we can stay there.
Can I just quickly say, this is the thought occurred, that the instruction was given from the very beginning. God gave us 10 basic principles. And if we look at those principles, his 10 commandments, we call them, they cover everything. And if we follow them, our relationship with him, our relationship with each other, we don't have to worry so much about the correction and reproof. But it's the fact that our foreparents, Adam and Eve, didn't pay attention to them, that we end up even here today. Amen. But they were the principles. And today, they're as lasting and meaningful as they were when he started that in heaven.
Brother Burris, share with us on Monday. You've been to university, and one of the things we took was hermeneutics.
Yes, yes, yes.
And we learned exegesis. Mm-hmm. We learned words don't just mean what they mean right there. So give us a little insight on words and their meanings as we approach the text as Adventists.
Well, let's put it this way. The easiest way to look at it is the fact that one word does not form, in a larger sense of things, one word does not form a text. That's one thing. It doesn't form a sentence unless that word is no, which has other sort of implications, no, I will not, or no, you will not. But in many cases, the words themselves, they have a text. They come in a text, and they also come in a context. It's difficult for you to understand the true meaning of a word unless you see it in its context.
Now, this word context, what does that mean?
This context means the area or the region in which it is situated. In other words, what is the surrounding points or focus of the word so that you can understand the meaning of the word itself as it sits in it?
Are you talking about if it's sitting in a region like Palestine or Babylon?
No, I'm talking about speaking in the region of an idea, uh-huh. that's being actually expressed. So the word is the sense that if you have a word, you have to look at it to the point of asking yourself, what is the writer trying to say? Mm. In other words, what's the best sort of interpretation of this word as we look at it in the greater context? So my immediate context may be in a sentence. I can look at it and say, John is green, today. But it may seem kind of strange, but if I came on and said that John was involved in a play and John had to play a certain part and John was green today, it would give you a different context. If I said it originally, it seems a bit strange. John's green today, I mean, what's the point of that? But now when we look at it in a greater context, we understand that John is green today for a reason. So that which seems sometimes that we understand, we don't always understand until we actually see it in the greater context of the area.
So a word could mean something here.
Yes.
And that same word can have a different slight shade or turn in another context,
yes,
environment.
Indeed.
Another usage.
Yes.
So let's look at a couple Bible texts, just two of them, that shows one same word in two different areas give off a different flavor. So let's look at 1 Kings 3, verse 6, Burge. And Sister DeGraff, would you look up Psalms 57, verse 3? And we'll see a word, and it means mercy. And the root word, because this is an Old Testament, is chesed. And the word chesed is used in both instances. So the person who writes it in English has to ask, what exactly were they trying to say with the word mercy in this instance? And what were they trying to say with it in another instance? And it's important to us to ask, what did the author mean by the word, not what am I bringing to the text with the word. There are some people who have something called word of faith ministries. They just take a word and just make it mean whatever it means today. But that's not what the original writer meant.
Mm-mm.
So you're coming for yourself as opposed to the Holy Spirit interpreting Christ's words. You may end up interpreting it as a word that leads to death when God meant it to be a word that leads to eternal life.
Indeed. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6, and Solomon said, you have shown great mercy to your servants, David, my father, because he walked before you in truth, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart with you. You have continued this great kindness for him, and you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day.
So in that context, the word mercy meant what?
Kindness.
Kindness, okay. Sister DeGraff?
Psalm 57, verse 3. He shall send from heaven and save me from the reproach of him that would swallow me up. God shall send forth his mercy and his truth.
So what is the hint or tone or flavor that the word mercy has in that context? The first one, it was mercy meaning kindness.
Mm-hmm.
But here we have a context, a man that's being pursued by somebody, an enemy. Mm-hmm. And we see mercy showing up again in that context. What is the flavor in that context?
Well, I think the fact that it's the same. He cares for me. And he's going to send forth his mercy, which indeed is truly how he feels. He loves me so much. His mercy will cover me and his truth. I guess that sort of, I'm going to leave it there. Somebody else can add to that.
I would agree. I think that it shows God's love. Because
yes.
God loves us so much. Uh-huh. He protects us from those who would hurt us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I like that. You intimated another word. It's protection.
Mm-hmm.
So in the verse that Burge spoke of, mercy talked about kindness. Mm-hmm. It's kindness to my father and to the children. Mm-hmm. Now we see a man being pursued, and God comes down and shows mercy, protection.
Mm-hmm.
So you see, it's the same chesed,
yes,
but in two different texts,
mm-hmm.
because of the context,
yes.
you get a different flavor. Why is this so important? Because at Adventist, we do have to be faithful to the text in its context and the bigger context of the plan of salvation.
Mm-hmm.
There are many people who have started new religions because they've taken a word out of its context and not looked at it in terms of the entire environment of the Bible, and they've started things and started a whole new religion. So this is why being faithful to the text in its context allows you to see more dimensions of the character of God, more elements of the plan of salvation, and it helps you to have a clear understanding of what God meant in that passage.
Mm-hmm.
I have, when I was studying this part, and especially about mercy, initially when I think of, besides this study, when I think of mercy, I usually think of pardon. Or, you know, somebody kind of forgiving you for doing something wrong or giving you a break on something. And so whenever I would read, you know, the verses that say mercy, like, oh, Lord, have mercy on me, I'm like, okay, this person has done a a bunch of stuff, and they're asking for forgiveness for something. Yes, but yes. That's not necessarily what it means, because mercy, I learned in reading this, is that it's used, especially in the Old Testament, to describe God's love, mm-hmm. his kindness, mm-hmm. and also the relationship that he has mm-hmm. with his people.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so pardon might be a byproduct a byproduct mm-hmm. of his love mm-hmm. and kindness and his covenant mm-hmm. attitude with us. Mm-hmm. But it's not just, oh, Lord, please pardon me or forgive me or give me a break.
Indeed.
It's, oh, Lord, I need your love. Mm-hmm. I need your kindness, or thank you for your kindness, mm-hmm. your mercy toward mm-hmm. me. And so mm-hmm. I think that it's really important to study the scriptures so that we can have a greater understanding of what it is we're reading. Because, mm-hmm. yeah, you can have that first understanding of mercy that I had, but understanding more fully that mercy really means God's love and his kindness and other applications, then it gives me a broader picture of mm-hmm. what mercy is all about in the Bible.
And I'm glad you said that, actually, because as we read this and as you study this here, it helps you to have a greater appreciation of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and like you were saying, like we have a very one-dimensional sort of idea of what God is like, but as we do word studies and we go deeper into the context of what it means, it actually shows us the depth and the width of God's love for mm-hmm. us, in the sense that it's not one-dimensional.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It is wide, it is mm-hmm. it is ever-encompassing. And mm-hmm. now looking at it from that point of view, can we not also say that because we recognize how much God loves us, how much more will we love God?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to share that. I mean, yeah. That's what struck me.
I mean, one of the things is the fact that our language is so limited.
Yes, yes.
The English language is very limited.
Indeed.
In that in Hebrew and Greek and these languages,
yes.
where there mm-hmm. were words that really expressed mm. more fully what it was God was saying or what's been said, we have one word that we expect to cover everything. And so the value of studying more, because like Ashley said, we can't just take one word and say it means this, because of our limitations in the English language, we do have to find ourselves studying more exactly what something means.
Indeed.
So for example, we have Mr. Burgess here. He's sitting there in front of a desk with a mic in front of his face. And if someone came in here and didn't know anything else, they said, oh, that's Burge. He must be have the people from the parolees, and he's probably deciding who gets to go, who doesn't get to go. Mm-hmm. Because that's Burge. Someone else will come in and say, oh, that's Burge. He's a preacher, and he's probably about to preach a sermon. So if it's the same Burgess, how do you know how you should take him? Because if you are a person that's going to follow the law and you see Burge and you know you broke parole, you're going to run out the door. But if you're a person who is struggling and want to get over something, you see, oh, that's Burge in front of the church extending grace and mercy, you're going to run down the front. It depends upon the context, the environment that he's in, what's its purpose, what's happening, what's he doing in that environment. Such is the case with the word. A word just pulled out of the Bible without understanding what it's doing in that environment, you may misinterpret the word or misapply the word. And such as this, with text messages, I'm not very good at text messages because, you know, some people would like to write a lot. I just like one, you know, two or three words and I'm going. That's bad. Because men have a problem with that. Come on, somebody.
Yeah, come on now.
You don't like to do all that text. No, worry about all that. But if one word can mean it can make a marriage or, come on, somebody, break a marriage. Just, you have to put some more context around it, but brothers, I'm just trying to help you out. The reason why your wife is not cooking that food this Sabbath is because of that text that you sent her. But she didn't understand that you were in the truck trying to text, the police was behind you, and all you could do is get her one word. Context! You got to look at the words in the environment, the circumstances around them, and that takes work. Another interesting word is shalom. Sister DeGraff, let's talk about shalom, the word peace, and how it can be used in different nuances.
Well, we have different Bible texts. I don't know if we want to refer to them.
Yeah, we can pick the first one and the third one.
Yeah, about peace. Mm-hmm. But we know that peace for most people, like I say, is it Greek or Hebrew? I don't know. Hebrew. Shalom, is it Hebrew?
Yeah, Hebrew, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And was used quite a lot by the Israelites as they went about sharing with one another and so forth. Peace, my peace, Jesus requires my peace, I leave with you, and not as the world leaves peace. So peace is used quite a lot. But in terms of, again, its context, does it always mean the same thing? Can peace have a different meaning? We would say peace, that means quiet, peaceful, all is well. You know, like God gives you perfect peace and all that stuff.
So actually, give me
like
another use
meaning.
Of peace.
But actually, what is it?
Yeah. Pardon? Give me another use of how peace can be used other than a parting word.
There was one of these texts. I want to say.
Because you're a healthcare provider. So I know one of those things jumped out at you.
Well, one of the texts, and I don't know which one it was, I'll have to look, it referred to peace as wholeness.
Yeah, that's the one, yeah.
And so peace doesn't always mean what you initially may think of as maybe the absence of chaos.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Peace also means wholeness in certain texts and completeness in God. And so if you are whole, if you want to take it literally, eating whole foods and things like that, when you are whole, then you have peace. Mm-hmm. So when you're missing something, you don't feel at peace. When you're missing something, you can't put your finger on it. Mm-hmm. You're like, I'm missing something. Or you're baking a cake. It's like, this cake is missing something. And, you know, you don't have peace about that cake. Uh-huh. Or you don't have peace health-wise, because there's something missing. You're not getting the whole nutrition that you need. So that is what peace is referring to, wholeness sometimes in the Bible.
It's interesting because in the book of Numbers, chapter 6, starting at verse 24, reads, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." Shalom. I don't know what everybody else's experience is like, but I know that my experience is such that after being in the presence of God, there is this quietness of spirit. You know, we can speak about the wholeness, but even if things are not quite whole, you know, things might not all be right. But once I spend time in the presence of God, there's a quietness of spirit that to me signifies shalom. It's the idea that no matter what is going on in my life, even if it doesn't look right to my naked eye, it makes all the difference in how I live my life. And once I get up and I move towards the rest of my life, there's this sense that no matter what happens, it's going to be all right.
Right. So we're going to put in the context in the original primary root text, yes, which was, you should know these words. They should be instructions. They will give you life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
An example for the word peace and how it can give life is the whole plan of reconciliation, the plan of salvation.
Yes.
When man fell out with Adam and God, there was no peace.
Mm-hmm.
There was no peace in his mind. Adam, he said, "I'm naked. I don't have peace." And there's somebody out there today that doesn't have peace with God. And it's not just peace because I'm at odds with God, but peace also is in the idea of the atonement. To be healthy, to be whole, to be restored, to be intimate. Shalom takes on the notion of a restoration, a healing, like a doctor that wants to give peace to a sick patient. And so the plan of redemption really is about a healing relationship to restore peace between God and man. And that's why Jesus always leads with peace. You see Paul talking about peace throughout the Old Testament, peace, because ultimately we're talking about this ultimate sense of intimacy, at one, Emmanuel, God with us, sanctuary, I want to be among you. This ultimately is the flavor that the word peace is trying to bring across.
I was just going to ask a question. Are we saying then that peace is a mental state?
Yes.
It's a mental thing rather than a physical
that's
thing.
That's one thing.
That's one part of it.
I would say,
No, that's what, you know.
I agree. I think that peace sometimes also means like a spiritual confidence.
Mm-hmm.
So no matter, like you said, no matter what is going on, it's a spiritual well-being, a state of well-being.
Mm-hmm.
And so peace means I have the spiritual confidence in knowing that I believe in an all-powerful God, an all-knowing God, a God who can fight all my battles.
That's right.
No matter what's going on around me,
that's right.
I have peace because think of the song, "When Peace Like a River, Tends My Way." Mm-hmm. It is well. Yes. You have a well-being
Amen.
Within your soul
Amen.
Because you know in whom you believe.
It's so the main like point Isaiah. Can I just want to say quickly, Isaiah 28, verse 26. I will keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on me.
That's right.
Because you trust in me. So it's got to be where I am in terms of my mental state, where I am, that makes a difference. I'm sorry, Dr.
Yes,
James.
No, and Isaiah 32:17, one of the texts on this part. In the King James Version, it says, "And the work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness and assurance forever." So then I said, I'm not sure, I didn't really catch everything. Mm-hmm. So I looked in the NIV Version, and it says, "The fruit of righteousness will be peace.
Yes.
Its effect will be quietness and confidence mm-hmm. forever." Mm-hmm. And so it's that quietness within your soul, within yourself, knowing that everything is okay because mm-hmm. God has everything in control.
Amen.
So the main point that this particular passage is about this day is not so much of mercy and peace. It's really about how a word
yes.
mm-hmm. can have different meanings mm-hmm. in different contexts.
Yes, indeed.
These are just examples of how one word can mean different things in a different context. Why is that important? Mm-hmm. Because if you don't read it correctly in its context, mm-hmm. you may come up with a wrong conclusion, and it may be the difference between eternal death and eternal life for somebody. Mm-hmm. This is the most important principle, that studying the word correctly will affect reproof, correction, righteousness, and ultimately salvation. Mm-hmm. And now, repeating words and patterns also have meaning. We're talking about another language. So the language we speak, English, some speak French, and these European languages use commas, exclamation marks, punctuations. The Hebrews didn't do that. Mm-hmm. In order to get the same idea across, one of the things they'll use is structure. A chiasm at the middle of this act would be the most important point. Another thing they'll use, the words would be shaped like an animal or an object, and it gives off a flavor of what that word means. But another thing they'll use is repetition. And repetition is not just to be curiously done, it's there for a reason. Mr. Graff, yeah, let's look at the very first text, Genesis 1, verse 26 and 27. Mm-hmm. There is a word that's repeated. Mm-hmm. And we want to know, why did God repeat that? Sometimes you just read things in the Bible, it's repeating, you just keep jumping over it. But there's a reason why it's repeated. Mm-hmm. And let's see what we can gather from that particular verse, Genesis 1, 26 and 27.
Okay, Genesis 1, 26 and 27 reads, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them."
What word is repeated over and over, Ash?
Created. We're just reading this emphasis that's placed on the fact that God created us. God is the one that created us. Mm-hmm. So it says, "Let us make man in our image." In the image of God, he created. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them and God said. So it's basically just reinforcing this idea, this principle that God is the one who created everything.
Okay, why is that so important today, Burge? I mean, okay, created. Is it created, or is it the noun, the pronoun, God created, or is it the fact that God actually created? What is this saying?
The strongest point is the fact that it was God who was the originator, and also the fact that God was able to do without anything else being in place. In other words, no one else can claim that. There's no other entity can claim that. Only God claims that he himself was the one who started. And when there was nothing at all, nothing existed, God says that I was the one that executed, that actually initiated everything in this earth. So what does that do? It flies in the face of evolution. It debunks that myth completely, because evolutionists are saying that things happened over a period of years and there was some big bang. Well, yes, there was a big bang, and I think that big bang was when God said, let there be light. And then there was a big bang, but otherwise than that, it wasn't something that happened over millions of years. It was something that God himself initiated, and no one else had anything to do with it.
That's excellent. Mr. Graff, want to share anything on that?
No, I would strongly agree that God created everything, and this was a special form of his creation. This was the end of the whole process, and he wanted to make it known. I'm going to create men in the image I want. Let us, the three of them, but he's going to do the creating, and he wants that known clearly.
One of the things that is important to always ask when you're reading a passage is, so what does this have to do with my salvation? Okay, God created. And one of the things that is very important is the notion that if he created, we must remember to submit to his authority, because you want to obey the one that created you, mm-hmm. not another created being. Mm-hmm. That our greatest tendency is to worship something. And that distraction, that wandering, is what causes us to look to other people for validation. So many people are looking for government, for education, for money, for their friends, their peers, the homeboy, the ace girl. Who are you looking to tell you who you are and give you a sense of home and make you feel like you're beautiful and you're accepted? There are a lot of people who are still hanging out with people who never created you, so they don't know you. They don't understand you. You need to go back to the one who created you, and that's the place where you find your identity. Mm-hmm. Salvation. If you think you created, you were not created, but that you just came up out of protoplasmic soup, amino acids that got together, made proteins, and then formed man, you're going to treat your life like you're just an object, like an animal. No, God created you and breathed something divine into you, that you have the capacity to live for eternity. And awareness that you created caused you to treat yourself entirely different than if you're just another object that's just here for pleasure and longevity.
Can I just interject one second? It's interesting because, again, once we look at the original language, we recognize that in the sort of environment that we live in now, everything is about the person. In other words, they're the most important thing. But in Hebrew talk and Hebrew language, it is the action that is the most important thing. We would write and say, God created. But the Hebrews say, created God. So in other words, Hebrews would say, Bara Elohim, and meaning that created God. The idea is that you are known more by your actions than by your identity. So very same in this situation. We've turned it around to the point where people just want to be accepted for who they are, no matter what they do. They want respect. They want to do all sorts of things, no matter what they do. But the Bible makes it clear, no. You are known by your actions. Mm. And so it's the same way today. Once we get that to known, that people will know who you are by how you conduct yourself, by how you live your life. It's a very strong principle for us today to recognize that if you want somebody to have an opinion of you, make sure you give them the right opinion.
Mm, that's powerful. One of the passages in Daniel chapter, we'll just move on to Daniel chapter 3. Down at the bottom. Ashley, why don't you share with us what was the repeated word repeatedly by Nebuchadnezzar? So you have this king built up an image, and he kept repeating this in the passage in Daniel chapter 3. Why don't you share that with us, Ashley?
The phrase was the image which Nebuchadnezzar set up. Mm-hmm. So it literally did repeat that 10 different times that this image was an image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And it was almost comical when I was reading every single verse, because I said, okay, I get it. By the end of this, I get it. This was the image that King Nebuchadnezzar set up, okay?
Yes,
if you know, once you read that chapter, if you didn't get anything else, you know that he set that image up. But it was to make a stark contrast between what was the image in his dream versus this image that King Nebuchadnezzar set up.
It's indeed.
Okay. Was it the image in his dream that he was making a contrast to? Because in Daniel chapter 2, there's an image that he gets a head of
gold.
Body of
silver.
Waist of
bronze.
Legs of
iron.
Feet of
iron and clay.
That's one image. Mm-hmm. Is that the image that Daniel was countering? So Daniel is saying the image that Nebuchadnezzar built up. But was that the image that Nebuchadnezzar was arguing against? Or is the one found in Daniel chapter 2, verse 44? Let's look at that image.
Daniel 2, verse 44.
Because remember, this guy's resisting something.
Yes.
What does it say in Daniel 2, verse 44?
It says, And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever.
So there is another kingdom or image that's being set up. That is what Nebuchadnezzar is resisting. That God is setting up an image. Nebuchadnezzar is saying, no, that image that's going to crush us all is not going to be set up. And because at the end he says, and who is this God that can deliver you from my hands? Mm-hmm. Nebuchadnezzar is making an attack against God. But why is this important? Because, I mean, look back at Lucifer, who sets up an image in heaven. It's between Lucifer and Christ. That battle goes all the way down into our lives. Just to the graph.
Now, I was going to say, don't we do the same thing? You know, when we stop to think about it, we know who our Creator is. God created us in His image, but we try to have our own form of creation and behavior. Like Brother Dwayne said, we want to do what we want. I want to do what I want to do. Create me? All right, you know, I didn't have anything to do with my birth as such, but I'm here now, and hey, I'm in control and I'm in charge. Mm-hmm. And we have to be mindful, because we're just like the Nebuchadnezzars, and just like even Adam and Eve, who trusted not the Creator, even though they knew He had created them. They trusted the created, even as they listened to the serpent, mm-hmm. and so forth like that. But how do we behave in that manner? Do we follow? I mean, we're talking about repetition, word patterns, and meanings, but repetition, we've heard it, but still, it's about me, me, me. And we have to be very careful of that. But we have to stop it, really, not be careful, because it will lead, as you said several times, to our destruction.
So the main point there was that repetition is a literary device in Hebrew language to reinforce the main point. Mm-hmm. So you don't just read it in his image, and this is a big deal to Daniel, who writes the book, that we need to be aware of, that what's driving Nebuchadnezzar, and he repeats it so that we can get that. Without kind of understanding literary devices, in other words, the way they use language, we may miss such an important point in that particular passage. Let's talk about text and context. Ash, what do you mean by text in context? That's in Wednesday's letter, text in context.
So basically, yes, text in context. So again, talking about words in scripture, also always occur within a context. And so the example that they used is Adam, the word Adam. It's used in Genesis for man, but it's used for Adam also as the first man. And then in other places, it refers to both man and woman, or humanity in general. So reading the word in within its context is important so that you can understand what message the Bible is actually trying to convey.
Back to the text message. Talking about the text message. Bring it home, Bert. Bring that plane down.
Well, again, yes. I found myself that...
Come on, confession is good for the soul.
I found through my own experiences that I sometimes don't even like to text when it comes to certain messages, because they are clearly taken out of context. Mm. And so when you're speaking to someone, unless you can understand the context completely, you can't get the nuances of what they mean. You can't look in their face sometimes and see what they mean. So again, we have to be able to look at it from a broader point of view and also understand the person that we're dealing with. Mm-hmm. So in many cases, when we're speaking about understanding the person that we're dealing with, what is the Bible writer trying to say in the context of everything he's trying to say? So this sentence, how does it fit in this word, how does it fit in this sentence? How does this sentence fit in this paragraph or this particular passage? And how does this passage largely fit within the whole book so that we can get a clear understanding of exactly what's being said? Because if not, we find ourselves extremely confused.
I talked to a friend this morning, and they explained to me this very thing, Now, she's a lawyer, and she has the words, but I don't know what these words are. There are three rules, canons. One is the major problem. One is something that leads to nonsense, and the other one is the golden rule. And I thought it was very interesting that, you know, if you don't know the problem, the issue that you're addressing, you may respond, and your response may be really off key.
Yes.
But the golden rule is always respond to the issue, the text, in its context. What's really going on? A lot of people get framed using social media. A lot of people. Because they'll copy something that you said with your name on the top on the WhatsApp message and send that around, but nobody knows what was being said. Were you responding to something?
Yes, of course.
Or were you telling someone something? Was it a joke? So text in context is so important. And a lot of times, a simple one is like this. You're walking on the street and you see somebody you know and they just walk past you. Now, you go and tell your friend, he just walked right, didn't even speak. Something else. Going to school and don't come back speaking to nobody. You didn't know that he just got a message that somebody had died. He had to rush up to Washington Mall, and he was saving a life. The context. But we run off with the fact that he went past me. Another context is what you bring to the table, your own issues. That's the context. He walked past you, but you always had people walk past you. You don't feel good about yourself. That context has caused you to interpret that behavior a certain way.
Can I give you an example?
Why not?
You know me. The point being, now, you know, I'm not the text, the older. That's not my generation. I don't do it that much. But here's the example. This millennial, I'll say, had sent a message to her mom, and the end of it was LOL. And she said, what that mean? She said, oh, that means, what is it? Lots of laugh out loud or whatever. Anyhow, the mother heard a story about someone who had passed. So she says, she didn't remember the meaning. So she says, LOL, to this person who had passed, or the family. Well, the daughter was upset. She said, all I was saying was lots of love to the family.
Oh, my goodness.
See, misunderstanding.
Yes.
Now, LOL, for the techie people, those who do all this fancy stuff, means generally laugh out loud or whatever, don't mean no big deal. But for this mother, who was being very compassionate and very concerned, she writes, LOL, sorry to hear your mama died, let's say LOL. She said, no, I just meant lots of love.
But that happened this week, Ms. DeGraff.
Pardon?
I put LOL in the group chat. Yeah. And you called me up
of
asking
course,
me, was
yes.
I laughing at you?
Yes.
Come on, Mr. Tell
that's
the church.
The same thing.
Tell the church.
It's the same thing.
That's why the LOL sticking
and
with you.
That's
you
why.
Thought I was laughing at you, Mr. Graff. I wasn't.
But that's
now we got that all out before Bermuda.
But that's
let's
the
move
reason.
On to turn.
No.
LOL.
That's the reason it's so important to still communicate, to be able to say, because
you did call me, you got contact.
To make sure that we got the full understanding.
Amen. Let's go to number on Thursday. Birds, books, and their messages. Talking about context, you can have a micro context, a word in an immediate environment, a paragraph. But you have to look at that paragraph in light of the whole book.
Yes.
Go ahead.
There are some books, obviously, you have the different books of the Bible, and all of them have a theme, and they have a message that they're trying to get. And sometimes, well, in a lot of cases, you have sentences that make up a paragraph, and paragraphs that make up a chapter, and chapters that make up a book. But usually, when you go through the book, you will see that there is a theme, there is a main idea that the author is trying to get to his audience. If you miss the overall idea of what the author is about, you can read a paragraph and take it, and many have taken it and used it to sort of bash somebody else, not understanding that the fullness of the content. I can think of maybe in the book of Colossians, and let me just be brief. In the book of Colossians, it speaks about eating things and drinking things and all of those sorts of things. And people use that as a means to say that God's law is done away with. But if you look at the context of the whole book, you will realize that it's not talking about God's law at all. But because, in many cases, people want to find a reason to justify what they do, well, here's the thing. If I want to justify something I want to do, I can take any old sentence out of context and make it appear as though it is what I say it is.
Mm. No, that's true. Yeah, I definitely get that. So the book of Matthew.
Yes.
Who is this audience, Burge?
The Jewish people.
The Jewish people.
The Jewish people.
So now Matthew, a book primarily written to the Jewish people, yes, has a genealogy of Jesus that deals with Jewish people.
Yes.
So the reason why he goes through Abraham, because he's trying to establish authority to the Jewish people. So you notice the book is a book for the insider. Mm-hmm. But then we have other books that are written to the Gentiles, the outsiders. So they'll show Jesus' genealogy that came down from another side. So depending upon the audience, the big book has a major theme. You have to read the text in that major context as well. Someone said, what's this got to do with me and salvation? But if you don't know the audience that the book is written to, you may see the same gospel written by someone else and missing things. So many people say the Bible can't be trusted because Matthew says it this way, Mark says it this way, John says it this way. Well, depending upon the audience, the emphasis would be different, mm-hmm, and the things that are left out were not majorly important to the point that was being made. So we have a text, what it says, its context, what does it mean in the environment that was written, and then the overarching context, what was the author trying to say in that book and its audience. Anyone want to add anything else to that, Burge?
Yes, actually, maybe look at the book of Genesis. You know, we look at the book of Genesis and understand why would that be important. We're talking about Moses now, who has led the people out of the land of Egypt, and they need a context for everything that's happened so far. So Moses goes through the process. God inspires him to go through the process of writing a book. But now he's written it before they get there. So he understands the book of Genesis before they even get to the Exodus aspect of it. But he already understands what's going on. And it is a reminder for them of the history of the relationship between themselves and God through their father, Abraham. Now, because he's able to do that, he's able to establish a foundation for them so that they know that they can trust him going forward. So by the time they get to the Exodus and all those sorts of things, they're already reminded of the things that have already gone on. So simple fact of the idea, we could talk about the Sabbath issue. Moses reminds them, this is the way it was in the beginning. I'm just reminding you of what's already taken place. And so the history sets the context for the whole Bible. The history sets the context for the whole world and creation in itself so that everyone, not just the Israelites, but everyone who ever lived would have an idea of who God was and how he relates to humankind.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yes. I think, yes, Genesis tells us about our origins at creation and the whole creation story and our history in that, but also sets the rest of the Bible up about the plan of salvation. Mm-hmm. And especially through the promise that was given, that was made to Abraham and also to Adam, even.
Yes.
Adam and Eve. So basically it is the introduction, mm-hmm, that we have for, mm-hmm, you know, giving us, mm-hmm, what happened in the past, but, mm-hmm, also giving us what the plan of salvation is moving forward.
Amen. It's the basis. It really is the basis for our direction. We started by saying we need, you know, the value of the Bible and what it does to direct us to be saved. Well, the book of Genesis really almost is a summary of the whole thing.
Yep.
From Exodus to Revelation, it's all consumed right there. And so it was important that he wrote Genesis, and then Genesis kind of singled out, so to speak. Not singled out like that, but it gives us the whole thing from the creation of the world all the way down, like you say, because immediately when they sin, what did he do? I'll put that enmity there, Genesis 3:15. That was our salvation, right, if we're prepared to accept it, and all the way through. So the book of Genesis, beginnings, as it is, I think, in English, is so valuable. And even for us today, you know, how does it apply to us? The same principles are there as we read from creation all the way through to our salvation are all consumed in the book of Genesis. So knowing that and following the messages, and of course the messages of all the other books, where they divide them up like into law, history, prophets, and minor prophets in the gospels, and all of that is necessary so that we can be saved and we have a better understanding for the Word of God.
So we've identified that, number one, the Bible is the source of authority. Mm-hmm. Number two, it has a purpose. Give us doctrine. What does the church believe? Mm-hmm. Reproof. You're going wrong. Correction. Need to change your ways. Instruction. Live your life differently. And this is difficult for people who have not bought into dying to self. Mm-hmm. If you haven't gotten the message of salvation, that by faith in his grace, you've got to recognize you've been crucified. These instructions, these reproof, these guidance will be rejected. We live in a world today that has a lot of confusion about lifestyle, marriage, raising children, health. And nobody knows where to go for a clear answer. Mm-hmm. It depends on what you want. Mm-hmm. If you want to have a good time, there is a source of authority to do that. If you want to do it your own way, there's a word out there for you to do that. But if you want to live life eternal, there's only one word, mm-hmm. and that's the word of God. Amen. Context mm-hmm. is important in Adventism because our major contribution to the world of Christianity is the great controversy context. Mm-hmm. Salvation of mankind is one thing, but securing heaven is another. That the character of God was under attack. That's the big context. And Lucifer was attacking God's authority and his character. He comes down and he gets us caught up into it. But still the big context is he's attacking God through us. If we miss the big context, we'll think salvation is trying to get into heaven. No, no, no. It's restoring us back to a God that we had lost relationship with in the big context of the great controversy. And we teach at the end that the God whose character was attacked, we tell the world, fear him, give glory to him. Why? Because the devil has lied about him. The hour of his judgment, his character is being judged, has come. Worship him. It is the big context of the great controversy that we got the three angels message. That text outside of the context may create legalists mm-hmm. who run around attacking other religions, mm-hmm. attacking people in different religions. That's not the context. Mm-hmm. Babylon has fallen. That's not the context. Mm-hmm. It's the great controversy that we can trust God and he has saved us and made us more than victors. Ashley, final thoughts.
I would say that this week's lesson just really confirms or reaffirms the idea and the concept that reading the Bible takes effort. It's not just a, you know, just a casual type of read. It's something that, you know, as you keep unfolding the meanings behind the words and as you just dig deeper and deeper, you just get a better understanding of what the scriptures are saying, and it turns really into a love letter mm-hmm. From God to mm-hmm. us. Amen. Basically saying, this is what, first of all, I created you. Mm-hmm. I put in a plan of a redemption plan for you to mm-hmm. save you because I knew what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And all you have to do is follow what I say. Mm-hmm. All of this is found in the Bible. Mm-hmm. Follow what I say and you will live a long life. Here on earth, maybe not as long as you would like, but definitely in the life to come, eternal life. Amen. So I think it comes to me as a love letter from God mm-hmm. the more that I study the Bible.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Well, I think Ashley said it very well. I think of the text. It's in Timothy. Paul said to Timothy, study to show thyself approved, a workman needing not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so if we do that, the language, the text, the context will indeed be such that we will know what the word of God says. It will, as it said in Deuteronomy, prolong our days.
So we're going to shift to what we call applications. We've done what does it say. We've done what this says. We've got 10 more minutes left, 10 or so. We've just gone through what does it mean. How does it apply to you as a pharmacist every day and the people you communicate to? The Bible is authority, reproof, instruction. What do we say to people in our context?
I think that it still reinforces the concept of love. Mm-hmm. And so you have to interact with others in love. Mm-hmm. You have to always check yourself, mm-hmm. Check your human emotions and your mm-hmm. tendencies to feel a way about things or to get angry or frustrated. Mm-hmm. You always have to stay in tune with God and think of, you know, not just what would Jesus do, but really, mm-hmm. what is God trying to tell me and also trying to communicate to others through me? Mm-hmm. So it's about the way I live my life, mm-hmm. About the practices, daily practices that I do, dietary practices, or even Bible study or going to church, things like that that enrich me personally, and I can share that with others. If somebody, you know, asks, well, you know, what do you do or what do you eat? Have you ever gotten that question? Mm-hmm. What do you eat? Mm-hmm. Then, you know, you can share that knowledge mm-hmm. and then direct them to the Bible from where you got the information. Mm-hmm. So it's always kind of pointing back to God, mm-hmm. even in the more practical areas of mm-hmm. life.
Mm-hmm. First, hard question. Practically speaking, why don't most people today use the Bible if it's so good? If it's such a good book, if it does so much good stuff, why is everybody looking everywhere else? What's the problem?
What I've seen is that there are many competing ideals out there. We have the media, we have those who are influenced by the media, so there are so many different ways of things coming. And then in many cases, many people have not even had the opportunity, and when I say the opportunity, it hasn't been presented necessarily to them that they can actually read this Bible and understand it. And on the other side of it too, just like Ashley says, it takes effort. It takes effort. So if you're going to put time into the Word of God, then you better be committed. Because at the end of it all, if you're not, because it takes effort, many will give up anyway, not realizing the benefits that come from studying the Word of God. And so even in my everyday life, I mean, of course, as a matter of course, it's unethical for me to sort of force what I believe on people. That can't happen. But there are many principles that I have learned through the Word of God that apply to everything I do. And so even not being able to necessarily mention the Bible, there are still many principles that are spoken of that they understand and grab onto, even for sometimes where they haven't considered it. Never thought of it. Well, nobody's ever told me this. No, we've never had this type of conversation. I never even thought about that. And I haven't mentioned the Bible. But what I have done is mention biblical principles. Because biblical principles are eternal. They're universal. They apply to every human being there is on the earth. And even to our viewing audience, let us never forget to the point where we are ashamed to speak about that which we know and we understand. Because there are ways of doing it that you are effective and you can minister to people in so many different ways and bring hope and life. One of the greatest things ever is to see one of your clients get up. They came in just hopeless. And when they leave full of joy. They're inspired to go and do something better with their lives. That's the greatest joy ever. And that's what we've been called to do. We've been called to bring hope to a dying world. And we can do it in so many different ways. And so the Bible and using it in context is the very best way that God has allowed us to do it because he gave it to us.
Amen. Sister Graff? So I want to ask you a question. Yes. That is, we ask why do a lot of people don't use the Bible today. Mm-hmm. One of the things I would tell you, like, well, before we go to Mr. Graff, is the Bible has a bad reputation. Mm-hmm. For hundreds of years, the Bible, a white horse, as we see in Revelation, a pure message that God loves you, and he's already declared you acceptable, accepted before you're acceptable. While you're doing bad things, God said, I'm going to pick you up and love you. That got mixed up. And, of course, in 325, we know the Roman Catholic Church came on the scene, and the Bible now develops a new reputation. So the Europeans eventually are beat down with the Bible, and they hate the Bible. They so happen to be the most powerful community in the world. So they have rejected the Bible in the scientific community as a source of authority, and they shape the world. So many people have got a bad image of the Bible, and they've never given it a try. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The Bible has got a bad reputation because of a controlling system that held it as a source of authority and abused people with it. Somebody, that's bull, but that's the truth. That's secular history, that's religious history, that's real. I say if you're listening, give the Bible a chance. to speak for itself into your life. Take off the blinders of our cultural context and see if it can give you some life. Because, unfortunately, sometimes, like a father may get a bad reputation, and when you go and meet the father, you say, he's not the person I thought he was. Such is the case with Jesus. Sister DeGraff?
Amen.
Come on,
I think you've all said it. But I do think, in addition to all of that, we who say we believe in the Bible,
come on,
we the supposed Christians, even Seventh-day Adventist Christians, don't always live out the word as it should be lived
out. Let's go to step. Why don't we?
Because of our pride, our self-centeredness. It's all again about me. I know this. Now, this is another thing. I could say I know the word of God, and I'm saying that as just generically, know it, study it, know the 2300 days, know the sanctuary, know all of that. But do I live it? Do day by day, I don't work anymore, but when I did work, did the people I worked with and for see Christ in me lived out from his word? Did the students I worked with, do my family, that's the first one, does my family see me as being the supposed Christian? I'm telling them, do this, do that, keep the Sabbath, you can't do all that kind of stuff. Are they seeing it lived out in me? If it's lived out in me, then it makes what I say of more value. So I believe that while all these things are true, we individually must examine ourselves and see whether we're in the faith and whether we're living according to, like I said earlier, God's basic principles, the 10 principles that he gave us to live by. Are we living by them so that we people will say, yeah, it's got to be real, because even though she's been through all of that, she's at peace. She's forgiven. She's done the things that the word of God says. And then they'll come and say to you, what is it? Tell me, what is there about you? Or what is there about what the way you behave that's so different? I can go back to this. So it, each one of us individually have to examine ourselves and see, how do we keep the word so it becomes real?
Many people harbor on self. It's yourself, and it's a veiled attack on people. And what that really resolves is we haven't really understand why we as a people have not been changed by the word. You can spend enough time attacking each other and then have nobody in the church. The real reason is because we haven't really understood the word. Because the change is not going to be because you've chosen to change. It's because something has happened to you. If you study the law and not understand the gospel, you may know everything, prophecy, law, rules, but have not had a change. Maybe we haven't studied the word correctly. And I think a clear understanding of the gospel has the power to even destroy self in every one of us. If we don't get that, the Bible may end up being the very tool that we use to kill ourselves. So a clear understanding of what Jesus has done, is doing, and will do is the only medication to treat the very problem you describe. And if we haven't understood it, we may go to hell with good intentions. Ash?
No, I agree. It really is about understanding and committing to what you read. So if you're reading something and you first pray and ask for the Holy Spirit to open your heart. And when you're reading it, you're reading with an open heart so that you can trust and believe in what you're reading and apply it.
No, you're just responding to the whole idea of why doesn't the Bible work? I mean, why isn't the gospel not changing the lives? We run around with Bibles and we're still the same. What happened?
Bible is not necessarily central to the lives of people. There are many who read it, but it's not necessarily central. You can read the Bible every day. Many do the Sabbath school lesson, but they do it as an exercise as opposed to a transformation experience. When I go to the Word of God, at least that's my personal experience, when I go to the Word of God, I'm expecting a change. I'm expecting to have an experience every time I go into the presence of God. And I'm also expecting for the word to reveal myself to me. And once the word reveals itself to me, it is my responsibility to decide what I do with that. Many will go and the word will speak. But the question will come down to, do they yield to what the word actually says? Because that now is the true indication of our character. The indication of our character is, do we have a heart that is willing to submit? Sister DeGraff, you said earlier something about pride. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what the word says if your heart is not humble. You can read it 15,000 times. It will not matter unless your heart is humble. Yeah. So again, I believe the centrality of the word is the greatest problem, but also, more than anything else, the bedrock of it all is the fact that we must be humble when we come to the word of God.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So the audience has some questions. One of the questions on reflection from the audience is, do we sometimes try to change scripture to fit our own selfish desires? That was with dealing with the Nebuchadnezzar piece. Do we sometimes change scriptures to fit our own selfish desires?
Yes, I was thinking about this last night. There was a different ways that we kind of twist the scripture, and maybe not even change scripture, but we change the how we follow the scripture. So in practical ways, just even with tithe and offering. And so God is asking for he's requiring the first fruits. So he's asking for a tithe of 10%. Then life happens, and then you're like, well, first you're like, yes, I'm a Bible-believing Christian, and I pay my tithe, and I give a liberal offering. And then life happens. And then COVID hits. You don't have a job for a couple of weeks, and you know the paycheck comes, but we're still in phase one, and we're okay, well, I don't know about this. This 10% is a lot, and electricity bill is coming up, Belco and Digicel, and I've got to pay for this and that, and this 10%, I don't know if I can afford it, but you know, we just kind of twist sometimes according to life circumstances, and we say, okay, well, I'll pay you back next paycheck, and I'll reimburse you, or you know, I'll square up with you next time. But no, it's not when we want to pay. It's when we get our increase, then that's when you return the tithe. And so sometimes we just twist, even if we don't twist the words of the scripture, we twist the application. In how we live our lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in closing, I think that the question is, what does Miss Anderson, Miss Williams, Miss Gibbons, somebody out there today want to, okay, what was this all about? That the Bible, if rightly understood, can not only protect you in this life, but also be a tool to access the life here to come. If we miss anything else, we need to rightly understand the Bible, because there are many people who study the Bible and unfortunately will end up in hell. A clear understanding of the scriptures is important because it may mean the difference between life and death. Thank you very much, panelists. Would you like to have a closing prayer?
Father, we thank you so much for our study of the context of the word today. Father, many of us have learned and we have find ourselves even edified, loving God, as we discuss this most important context. And we pray, loving God, that we would have right interpretation through contextual reading of the word of God. Father, just like in our lives, we want to understand things in the proper context, how much more important, Father, would it be that we understand your word in its proper context, that we might go forward with full understanding and edification because your spirit has led us to a right interpretation. Father, it is through your word that we will have a long life. And so we pray for that long life, even as we pray for understanding of your word. Be with those in television land and internet land, loving God. And we pray that they were blessed and edified through this experience. And we welcome them back next week, loving God. They might receive even more edification through the word of God at the Lagos University. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
don't need another political uprising. We don't need another conqueror on the sea. But what we need is a special word that will burn within our hearts and give us direction from above. We need a word from the Lord, a word from the Lord, just one word from the Lord. We'll move all the doubt and cause the sun to shine and give us peace of mind. Speak,
Corinthians chapter 4. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken.
Cast down, but not destroyed. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't even matter what you think you're going through. Just remember these words.
Your letter will be get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us treat each other like sister and brother. Let us all get together with the Lord. Nations against nations fighting in this land. So many things they're fighting for, we just don't understand. Confusion is going on, causing many to pause. We should all get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us treat each other like sister and brother. Let us all get together with the Lord. The Lord moves in mysterious ways, His wonders to perform. He plants His footsteps on the sand, and He cries in every storm. The Lord will walk beside you, and He'll guide you all the way. We should all get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us treat each other like sister and brother. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us talk together. Let us sing together. Let us pray together with the Lord. Let us treat each other like sister and brother. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us talk together. Let us sing together. Let us pray together with the Lord. Let us treat each other like sister and brother. Let us all get together with the Lord. Let us all get together with the Lord. With the Lord.
Never would have made it.
Come on, Simone.
Never
You're still her today.
That's right.
Hallelujah. And you've learned lessons along the way, yes? So I want you to declare to God right now that I'm stronger. I'm stronger.
I'm stronger.
I'm wiser.
I'm wiser.
I'm better.
I'm better.
Anybody better?
Much better. Yeah.
Good morning, church. Morning, saints of God, and a happy Sabbath to you all. Our call to worship. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is our call to worship.
Let us pray together. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for your goodness and for your grace. Thank you for the privilege we have to come into your presence and receive refreshment from the Lord himself. Speak to our hearts today. Change us from within. To the many that are watching all over the world, and even our own church family here in Bermuda. Send angels that excel in strength to be in their homes, that they may receive the refreshing of the Lord, even though they're unable to be in your temple. Keep us to this end, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Again, we are going to open up the service with our opening hymn this morning, number 598, Watch Ye Saints.
Keep your legs so trimmed and burning, ready for
We look forward to our master's returning. But while he yet tarries, we have a duty to pray. We have a duty to lift up our brothers and sisters before the throne of God. There's a song that says, I want my friends to pray for me. I need the prayers of those I love. At this time, wherever you are, think about a loved one. Think about a friend. Think about a family member. And lift that person up in prayer. There are many things that are happening around the world today. People are dying. Men's hearts are failing them for fear. Think about one person and lift them up in prayer as I pray for you all. Loving and our eternal God and Father, we come before you once again, O loving Lord, sinful and wretched, we kneel before thy throne, unholy, unworthy, unrighteous, undeserving of your love. But through the power and the gift of the Holy Spirit and through the blood of Jesus Christ, we are able to come boldly before the throne of grace, knowing that we can receive mercy even in this time of need. And so, O Lord, we plunge ourselves because we know that there's a fountain filled with blood, and that fountain is drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and that sinners who are plunged beneath that flow will lose all their guilty stains. So we present our sins before you, O Lord, and we ask in humility for your forgiveness. Your people, O Lord, are sick. They're dying. Your people are fearful for the things that are happening around in this world. And so, O Lord, I lift up every member of this church. I lift up every individual that is listening at this time. As your children are on their knees, they're praying for their loved ones, they're praying for their friends. We ask, O Lord, that you may send holy angels that excel in strength to be with these individuals. We pray that you may tabernacle with them, that you may draw nigh to them as they draw nigh unto you. We, O Lord, recognize that we are indeed living in perilous times. But we are thankful, O Lord, that we have a Savior who still sits on the throne. We are thankful that there's a God that still sits on high, and He is involved in the affairs of human beings. O Lord, at this time, Your manservant has prepared a word from You. So, O Lord, we ask that as He declares this word, may You give Him power, may You give Him clarity, and may You give Him authority. And may as He speak Your words, may they fall on receptive hearts. And may Your words accomplish what they may, and may they not come back void. O Lord, we ask that You bless Your people. We ask that You deliver a blessing upon us today. For we know, O Heavenly Father, that even though the world is in turmoil at this time, we know that there is coming a day when there will be no need for ventilators or face masks. We know that there is coming a day when there will be no sickness and no more death. There is coming a day, O Lord, when sorrow and the grave will be no more. A day when we'll go home and live with You eternally. We look forward to that day. We continue in that hope, and we pray, O Lord, that You may save us unto this end. These mercies we ask in Jesus' name.
Without a care, so carry your candle
God bless you, friends. We are so happy that you have joined us today. We wish to welcome you to the Hamilton Seventh-day Adventist Church, where worship is a joy and the love is real. It is our petition today that the grace of God, the goodness of God, and the gift of His Son, Jesus the Christ, will, not would, but will, make incursions on your heart, arrest your attention, and facilitate your salvation on this holy and blessed Sabbath day. We are so glad that you are with us, those of you that are watching through ATV. If you're having any challenges there, feel free to tune in to our YouTube channel, Hamilton SDA YouTube channel, or on live stream, the platform live stream, Hamilton SDA. And again this week, we wish to welcome our listening audience there on 105 here in Bermuda. We wish to welcome all of you that are listening by radio to our services today. We are delighted that you have joined us. Just want to let you guys know of a couple of things that continue to happen. And one of those is that tomorrow at 3 o'clock, we will continue, and as we have been, with our feeding program. We feed anyone who is in need, anyone who is hungry. And I say this to those who are listening and watching. We seriously want you to know that on Sundays at 3 and Wednesdays at 4, you are welcomed to come here to the Hamilton Seventh-day Adventist Church, and you will be fed. It's amazing. During this time of social distancing, it's such a joy to see fathers and even single mothers show up here, not just to get food for themselves, but to get food for their whole families. And it is our joy. It is our privilege. There will be no holding back from you. We want your family to eat on Sundays and Wednesdays. We want them to eat every day of the week. But here at Hamilton, we are providing that for you on Sundays and Wednesdays. So do not go hungry. Don't be sitting at your house hungry. Come on in where the table is spread. Pick up your carryouts and be able to feed your family during this time of crisis. Indeed, these are difficult times that we are living in. It's amazing. It seems like the months and weeks are just kind of flying by. But we're thankful because it could have been worse here in Bermuda. We're thankful for the leadership in our government. We're thankful for their hard work day and night to keep us safe and to make sure that this pandemic has as little detrimental effect on us as possible. Indeed, we're thankful again for your presence here today. We welcome you to our services. We pray that you are blessed. Enjoy it all. Enjoy all of it. But more importantly, let Jesus come into your heart today and refresh you from above. God bless you and enjoy this Sabbath experience.
Now, this is the time where we will fellowship with each other. If you're sitting at home listening or watching and you have others in your home, feel free to reach out and touch them. We have to socially distance from each other, but you don't necessarily have to at home. Just, you know, reach out and touch someone next to you as we sing this fellowship song. Everybody say bless,
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 bless.
We're blessed when we
Good morning, church. I received a call from a young man in the United States. He was a bit anxious when he called, and he said, Stanley, I have a question. I said, what is it? Now, he's about 36 years old, he's 38 years old. He's in pretty good shape, and he says, should I get tested? And I began to think, well, where do you live? He says, I live in a pretty nice suburban community. Okay, have you had anybody visit you? No, I've pretty much been here by myself working. Have you had any cough, fever, or chills? No symptoms like that. Is there anybody near you sick that is positive? No, everyone is well and everyone is healthy. He said, but somebody called me and told me that they've set up a center nearby, and I'm wondering, should I go and get tested? Testing is a big issue right now here in Bermuda. Everyone is being afforded the opportunity to be tested. And the question is, okay, so should you get tested? And if you do get tested, what do you do with the information? I myself have to ask, do I, should I, when do I, and how do you use testing? I'm sure there are people who are listening. You've asked yourself, should I go and get tested? And you've seen the videos of people having things put into their nose. I myself have actually participated in doing the testing, and I can tell you, it's not always for the faint of heart, depending upon the person doing it, and depending upon the person's nerves, and if you grab the person's hand, it's a lot going on. So testing. In America right now, they definitely have noted that there are a lot of people who have been tested. Actually, there are 10,217,000 people in America that's been tested. Out of the 10 million, 1,500,000 have been positive. So 15% of the people who were tested were actually positive. Now, another issue is what type of test. You know, there's a big discussion of a viral test that's called PCR and a serology test that's an antibody test. What's the difference? The PCR test tells if the virus is there right now, replicating, making new babies. Well, if it is, then you can give it to your granny. You can give it to your nana. You know, you have the disease. There's one called serology or antibody. That just says you've been exposed to it at some point in time in your life. It was in your neighborhood, you know. But you don't necessarily have it right now. You've just had his fingerprint left on you. But that's not helpful to see whether or not you can get somebody infected right now. It just says you've been exposed to it. So different tests, types of tests, have different purposes. So when someone asks, should you get tested? So I asked the guy, what tests do they have in your neighborhood? He didn't know. He said, nah, you done it. They just said they're testing us. Called back a couple of days later, and he said, well, the test they have is both. I can get either one. Which one should I get? Then I said to him, well, what information do you want to know? Because if you're not coughing, if you're not sneezing, you don't have chest pain, you don't have body aches, if I test you today, all that means is that you don't have the disease today. But I didn't think you had it anyway because you didn't have any symptoms. You didn't have a high pretest probability. So I personally, as a clinician, would tell you, you don't have to be tested because nobody's traveled and come near you. You've not been near a person that's positive. You have no symptoms. You don't have a high likelihood of having the disease. But I just want to get tested. Okay, that's your choice, but you asked my professional opinion. So he goes and gets tested and says, man, look, I ain't got the disease, praise the Lord. But he probably wasn't going to have it anyway. So next week, he's going to come and say, I didn't have it last week, but you think I should get tested this week? So this can go on and on and on. When should you get tested and which test should you use?
You should talk to your doctor about that, because your doctor will tell you whether or not the information that you get will be useful for determining can you infect somebody else, or simply if you've had exposure, or if it really makes sense for you to get tested. I would suggest to you, if you have fever, if you have chills, if you have cough, if you have any symptoms like that, you definitely need to be tested. Another group of people that need to be tested are people who were positive in the hospital, or positive, and then after a period of time, the symptoms are going, test them again to see if they got over it. Testing can be used to screen for the presence of the disease or the resolution of the disease. Is it gone? Because when you leave the hospital, you don't want to go coughing on people and give it to them. So you need to make sure it's cleared up. Testing purposes. You also got to know the purpose of the test and how to interpret it. So that's the information for today. Serology testing. The other one, antibody testing. What good is it? Well, it's good for people that want to study how many people in the country has had it. It also might suggest if you get the disease again, you may be able to fight it. We don't know that yet. So don't let anybody lead you down the road telling you, do the antibody test, it can tell you that you can fight it off again. We don't know that. Also, don't just go jumping and getting tested because it's around thinking that you're cured, because you just don't have it today, but it doesn't mean you're not going to have it tomorrow. Discuss testing with your doctor. Don't just go do a test and come with the wrong information. Well, you know, testing is a big thing. Even in this world, there's testing. Now, not everybody in the universe will be tested, but you and I will have to face a test. Does the whole universe? No, just those people who have been contaminated with sin. Those people who have fallen because of the sin nature and now find themselves having to face a judgment, a test, not just to see if you've been exposed to the disease of sin, but if you still have that disease of sin replicating in you. And that test will be the law of God and his character. We will be tested. As a matter of fact, testing not only started down in Southside, but in 1844, testing started in the courts of heaven. The Bible says that the great God of the universe came and set down the Ancient of Ages and began to open up the books and began a testing of you and a testing of me. Because he could not allow that virus of sin to enter back into heaven. So he has to see who has overcome the virus of sin. We need to have some testing going on. I don't want you to die and not be aware that the testing is not going to start, but the testing already started in 1844. And I've got some other news. Testing is about to close down. It's going to come a time, and he says, he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. So I'm going to tell you, you don't need to do a serology test. You have been exposed to it. You don't need to just do a PCR test. I know that the sin virus is replicating in you. You need to do a blood test. You need to test to see if the blood of Jesus Christ is coming through your veins. Because it's only the blood of Jesus Christ that will be the vaccine to fight off the virus of sin. And if you don't have the evidence of that test having cured you, I'm sorry, you're going to have to be condemned to hell. But it's not necessary. For way has been made a way for you to pass the test. And it was at the cross of Jesus Christ. He died for you, and he died for me. Hope we pass the test. God bless you.
Good morning, church. Today's scripture reading will be taken from Job 19, verse 25. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and he will stand upon the earth at last. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Good morning, church, and a great and good morning to all the boys and girls out there who are watching via the media. Boys and girls, tell your mom and dads that it's your time and that they need to just back away from the TV a little bit to allow you to come in close to hear the story that's been prepared just for you. Today's story is entitled, Spinny the Spider's New Shoes. You see, there was a country called Everlasting Peace. And in that country, there was a shoemaker. He wasn't just any shoemaker, boys and girls. He was the bestest shoemaker in the whole wide world. He made shoes for people like Shaquille O'Neal. He made shoes for people like Barack Obama. And I looked at your pastor, I believe he made his shoes too. Amen. He was the best shoemaker in the whole wide world. And one day the king called upon his service and asked him to make him a pair of amazing shoes with diamonds and rubies. Precious stones. The shoemaker agreed to this. Who wouldn't agree to make a pair of shoes for the king? And so the shoemaker got his leather. He got his gold thread and his needles. And he began to stitch some shoes for the king. As he was stitching shoes for the king, the window beside him in flew 5 flies. And those flies began to buzz around the shoemaker's head, buzzing around and around, making it very difficult for the shoemaker to concentrate and make these extraordinary shoes. So the shoemaker took out some paper and he got a pen and he began to write, "Whoever can get rid of these spiders, these annoying flies, I will make them a brand new pair of shoes." So he took these posters and he walked all around the kingdom, posting them on every tree, posting them on every door, posting them wherever he can. Pretty soon, everyone in the kingdom saw the posters, and they came to the shoemaker's door and knocked. The shoemaker let them in. The first person that came in to the shoemaker's house was a baker. He was the royal baker. He came in with his pot and his bowl, and he started to mix stuff all around in his bowl. And he was looking at the flies as they were flying around. And then he took his flour and he started all over trying to get, I'll clean it up, Pastor, trying to get the flies. He had no such luck. Next person came in was the royal guard. They came in, had their hat on their head, and took their sword and was all around trying to get the flies. No such luck. Exhausted, they sat down and then all of a sudden, there was a small, tiny knock on the door. The shoemaker got up, and he came to the door and opened it up. He looked, boys and girls, and he looked again. He couldn't see anyone, and then there was this still small voice. Down here. Mr. Shoemaker, down here. The shoemaker looked down. Oh, there you are. What can I do for you, little fella? Spinny said, don't worry, I have come here to solve your problem. You? The shoemaker looked at the baker. The baker looked at the guard. And they all done their royal laugh. Ha, 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 ha. How can such an insignificant little fella like you help with a great big problem? Spinny paid them no mind. He just crawled along the floor. Brother Nathan, he crawled up the wall and found his position right there, little boys and girls, right at the window. And then he took one deep breath and began to jump from one side to the next, spinning the most beautiful web. And then he stopped. The shoemaker, the baker, and the guard looked and waited. One by one, to their amazement, the flies came. Zip, zip, zip. They all had their mouths open. Only thing Spinny the Spider could say at that time was, God, I give you thanks for what I'm about to receive. Lunch. You see, boys and girls, don't let anyone tell you that you're not big enough, that you are too small, that you are insignificant. Because in God's kingdom, there is a special place for every one of you. There are things that your pastor cannot do. There are things that your elders cannot do. But God has called you, and he has given you specific talents and gifts that you can use in his kingdom. We look at people like the boy with the loaves and fishes, how the master called on him. We look at David when all the big adults were trembling. They saw a giant. David saw a challenge. So boys and girls, know this. You are big in God's sight. Thank you, and have a good day.
Good morning, church. Will a man rob God? You have robbed me in tithes and in offering. The next verse says, you are cursed with a curse because you have robbed me. In this chapter, Malachi chapter 3, verses 7 to 11, it talks about blessings and curses. We hear about the blessings, but we don't hear too much about the curses in this verse. And I asked myself, I said, God, what type of curse are you putting on your people who do not return a faithful tithe and offering? And in the spirit of prophecy, in the book Pacific Union Recorder, God says that the curse is defined as the absence of the blessing. In other words, if God is withholding a blessing from you, you are living under the curse. That is the curse. Don't you find it strange, church, that some people who do not return a faithful tithe and offering seem to be blessed, seem to be wealthy and prosperous? This was the question asked 125 years ago. The spirit of prophecy says that in God's great mercy, he is sparing the lives. He is sparing their lives that they may see and repent. God is trying to persuade them that the blessing comes from God, and it is his benevolent hand in which their prosperity comes from. There are others who are living under the curse of God. Everything they touch just doesn't work out, and their lack of abundance and blessings shows. God is trying to use their hardship to motivate them to seek God first. In closing, all of us have been hit by the coronavirus storm. Many cannot afford their rent. Landlords cannot pay their mortgage, and the banks are still asking for their money. Businesses are failing and have failed. People have lost their jobs, have taken pay cuts, and the bills are still coming. Do you want God to bless you in these times? Return, beloved, a faithful tithe and offering. You want God to rebuke the devourer? You want God to bless your house? You want God to bless you despite the pestilence that stalks the land? God says, return unto me, and I will return unto you. Return, beloved, a faithful tithe and offering, and watch the Lord pour out a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive. At this time, wherever you are, bow your heads and close your eyes as we pray for the monies that are to be collected from the tithes and offering by online and the Hamilton Seventh-day Adventist Conference. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we ask us, help us to stop stealing from you. Help us to stop compromising. Help us to return our faithful tithe and offering so that you can bless us in these times, in these last days that we're living in. We ask, Lord, that you watch us wherever we are. Watch over us and bless us in the name of Jesus. Let the saints say, amen.
along with us. The Lord is blessing me right now.
Our scripture reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Amen. Okay, saints, it is time for praise and worship.
Amen.
We've brought our offerings to the Lord, and now we want to offer our praise and our worship to Him today, this morning. We're going to start with a simple song. We sing the praises to our King, for He is the King of Kings. If you believe that today, join with us, whether you listen to us on radio, YouTube, anywhere. Just sing along with us.
Glory, for He's the King of Kings. Give Him glory. right. Okay, so.
Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
How many believe that God is everything? Is he your everything? Is he your beginning, your end? Is he your Alpha and Omega? Because he's Alpha and Omega, we worship him today. So sing with us as we praise his holy name, our Alpha and Omega.
You are Alpha.
Let us pray together, Spirit of the living God. The wee hours of this morning, you and I had a conversation about this moment. Speak now, for thy servant is listening. In Jesus' name, let the redeemed of the Lord say amen. Come on, somebody say amen out there in YouTube land, in live stream. Matter of fact, turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor out there on YouTube. Turn to your neighbor in your house and say, neighbor, I'm so glad I at least feel like I'm in the house of God. We are happy to be here today to bless the name of the Lord. I lift up before you today a familiar passage, one that speaks to the times that we're living in, one that helps to emphasize in a very real way what God has called us to do in these last days. If I could just get a little more volume. The Bible says in verse 16 of the first chapter of the epistle of Paul the Apostle to the Romans, the Bible says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. I have entitled this generative, this revolutionary, this remonstrative pericope, we're Protestants, we protest. We're Protestants, we protest. It is an amazing thing to be living during these times in Earth's history. And I had to step out on faith this past week. I have been alive now for just over 40 years, and just over 40 years, and throughout my entire life, I have never cut my own hair. I have done my beard on many occasions. I've done the goatee, I did the full, I've done that, that's every single week. But I've never cut the top of my hair. Not the top, not the sides, not the back. That I have always left to a barber. Well, I want you to know, church family, as you sit out there listening, here at Hamilton, we have many elders. We have many elders at Hamilton. I think we have about 13 that serve. I think there's about 22 or 24 in total. Not all of them serve. Some of them are emeritus. They've already done their time. But in our elders group, we have a group on WhatsApp. We have a WhatsApp group. Yes, I'm turning to look at one of the culprits. I'm looking at one of the culprits. Because there were a lot of things said last week on the elders' chat about the preacher's hair. There were a lot of things that they were saying. Like they had a Beavis and Butthead routine going on there. I mean, they were running jokes. Like, matter of fact, when I left the pulpit on Sabbath, there were about 58 messages from my elders. I'd say maybe 10 to 20% were rejoicing over the sermon. But the other 80 was ridicule for the preacher. Yes, I just want to turn to my right and look at one of the culprits again. Because it's important to realize that this caused me to say in my mind that I needed to do something about it. And I went on Monday morning. I decided if I'm going to do this, Terry, that I do it on Monday morning. I needed 6 or 7 days for anything to recover that got messed up. I needed things to be all right when I came to church. And I took out the blade and I put it on the two guard and I just methodically just kept going over it. Because all I could remember was cutting my own son's hair and how I just keep going over. And I kept going over it. I'm watching huge globs of hair drop into the sink. And I'm fearing for my life. I don't know what's exactly happening to me. I'm starting to feel the cool breeze hit my head. And I'm saying, what have I done? What have I done? I stuck at it. And I watched a little video from my friend who cuts hair, Lee Lamb in Huntsville. And I stuck to the plan. And because of that, I, like Paul today, can stand here and say, I am not ashamed. I am not ashamed this morning. And I'm speaking this directly to my elders who are watching. I am not ashamed. There's one in particular that led this charge. There's a couple of them, actually, that led the charge. You had one, I'm not going to call his name. Some refer to him as Clarendon. I'm not going to call his name. But they had some things, you know. Even my head elder, I'm not going to call his name either, but my head elder sold me out on the check. His job is to stand by me. And he abandoned me. He cracked all kinds of jokes. But I'm thankful today, after I did it, that I had the courage to do so. I was afraid. I was nervous. I'm even seeing now where the elders have a bunch of things to say, but I don't particularly care. They can say what they want. I always have the bully pulpit, you know what I'm saying? So I can always correct. I can correct their accusations. But it's important to realize that because I stepped out on faith and had courage, I was able to do something that I had not done before. It's important to realize, because when we talk about the Protestant Reformation, one has to consider that these gentlemen that led out in this Reformation were doing something that had never been done before. Never before had someone stood up against the Roman Catholic Church. Now, I've got to pause here just for a second, because there are some amongst us, even amongst our faith, that get nervous when we preach these kinds of sermons. It makes them a little on edge. It makes them a little flustered. And I would apologize if I could, but there's nothing to apologize for. The truth is that God has a specific message for this time, and we have been called to deliver it. I even had someone say to me last week, Pastor, you know, it was Mother's Day weekend. You should have preached a Mother's Day sermon. I told him I did, Terry. I preached about the mother of all harlots. That's what Revelation calls her. And the truth of the matter is that in these last days, they are not for the faint of heart. They are not for the weak and the weary. You've got to understand that if you're going to stand in these last days, you've got to have some backbone. It's amazing, because one of the great reformers goes by the name of Martin Luther. And I want to spend just a little time talking about the things that Martin Luther protested. Understand that this was a time of the Reformation. This was a time when they decided to stand on the Bible. And Martin Luther began his criticism of the Roman Catholic Church right around 1517, when he nailed 95 theses onto the door of the steps, walked up the steps of Wittenberg Church and nailed his thesis to the door. Now, it's important to realize that he began by criticizing the sale of indulgences.
understand that at this time and even to this day, there are many false teachings that have been taught. And I'm challenging the Protestant church families in Bermuda to realize that we are still Protestants and we must still continue to protest. That means whether you are a Lutheran, whether you are a Calvin, whether you are a Methodist, whether you are African Methodist Episcopal, whether you are Pentecostal, whether you are Church of God, whether you are Anglican, you are all a part of the Protestant movement, and you need to understand that God is calling upon us in this day and age to protest. It's very interesting because Luther began by criticizing the sale of indulgences. You need to understand that during Luther's time, it was an incredible time for the sale of indulgences. You say, what are you talking about? Well, indulgence was such that you could actually buy an indulgence, which actually would, if you would, get your dead loved ones moved to higher places. So your loved one dies, and in essence, you go and pay some indulgences, you get these things taken care of, and you can move from getting your loved one out of hell into purgatory. Or you can move them from purgatory into heaven. This was the things that were taught, and you need to understand that on the streets all over Europe, there were hustlers, there were church hustlers out in the streets preaching and offering up the sale of indulgences to the extent they would get highly dramatic. They would say, I see your dead mother right now burning in the flames of hell. Give your indulgences. Go ahead and get them so you can get your loved one out of hell. And poor people, widows, the broken, the low of society, put all their money into the hands of these church hustlers just so that they could think in their mind that their loved one was no longer in hell. It's an amazing thing because Luther insisted that the Pope had no authority over purgatory. And I have to pause it there because it's interesting that the Protestant Reformation continued to advance forward in its actual teachings. It didn't have everything at first, but over time they quickly learned more and more and began to protest against more and more. And Luther came to him and said, listen, the Pope has no authority over purgatory. Well, the truth is, what Luther didn't understand at that time was that there was no purgatory. There wasn't even a hell, neither is there a hell today. The truth is that Luther, in just preaching against this, highlights a big fundamental flaw of the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. Some say, well, why do we focus on them? Well, we focus on the Roman Catholic Church because all these other churches came out of her. And most of the teachings that are false, they got from her. Oh, friends, understand that he insisted that the Pope had no authority. Well, understand this, that in order for you to even believe in a purgatory, you have to first believe that when you die, you're not really dead. You first have to believe somehow that when you die, you go somewhere else. One of the greatest deceptions that come to us from the Garden of Eden is that ye shall not surely die. The lie that the devil told to Eve is still permeating society today. This idea that when you die, you're not dead. That you're still floating around. That you go to heaven or you go to hell or you go to purgatory or you become an angel. You have seen, you've been to many funerals, Bermuda, where even when they do the video presentation of the loved one, they'll even show doves or if you would, flying up into heaven. They release balloons and release doves in idea of releasing the spirit into heaven, when the truth of the matter is the Bible says that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. And you have to understand that your loved ones, church family, your loved ones, Bermuda family, your loved ones, radio family, are not in heaven right now. They're right at the grave where you left them, waiting for either the first or second resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's interesting because he protested also against the treasury of merit, that it had no foundation in the Bible. One of the teachings that the Catholic Church still holds to is that when Christ got on the cross, that his merits were in such abundance that now you could actually partake of them by doing certain activities, by saying or pronouncing a certain amount of prayers, by doing a certain amount of penance. You could actually tap into the merits of Christ. But we have to understand today that salvation, church, is a free gift from God. There's nothing you can do that will warrant you eligible to receive salvation. It is a free gift of God. Grace is unmerited favor. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't achieve it. You can't even get to a place where you can say, I've done enough for God to give me his forgiveness and his grace. Because God's grace is not for sale. It is a free gift. And Martin Luther challenged the church over and over again that in essence, you cannot keep trying to sell people's salvation. Salvation is a free gift from God himself. It's amazing, friends, because the Reformation continued to develop and gave a distinction between law and the gospel. It actually then began to point to the phrase that many of us are familiar with if we had been studying our Sabbath school lesson, that is sola scriptura, if you would, a complete reliance on scripture as the only source of proper doctrine. We as Protestants stand on the Bible and the Bible alone. What I'm challenging my fellow Protestants in Bermuda to understand that some of us have not gone far enough. Some of us are still holding on to the false teachings of Rome, and we are still perpetuating them in our churches today. We still, if you would, there are some of you tomorrow that will head out to church. Many of you headed out believing that it is the Lord's Day. This is a false teaching from the Roman church that she willfully acknowledges is something that she established and that there is no foundation in Scripture for. Understand that we ought to stand on the Bible and the Bible alone. That is our rule of faith. And there's nowhere in Scripture that remotely suggests that the first day of the week is a holy day. The truth of the matter is that God has placed us in this place in Earth's history because it's time to protest again. It's interesting because in 2017, it marked 500 years of the Reformation. And there were some Protestant leaders that said that the Reformation had accomplished what it was supposed to do because it had greatly reduced the sale of indulgences. But that's not the only false teaching that the church has pushed on us, whether it's transubstantiation, whether it's sprinkling at baptisms, whether it's the state of the dead, that somehow when you're dead, you're still alive. There are false teachings after false teachings that are permeated throughout. And it's amazing because even to the extent that you have to understand that part of these prayers, part of these petitions were such that you didn't just pray to God. Even to this day, you can pray in their teachings to one of the saints, and one of the saints up in glory will speak to God on your behalf. Now, it's very interesting because in order to become a saint, you must live on earth, live a good life, die, go straight to heaven, and then at least two individuals down here on earth need to pray prayers directly to you that when the actual miracle is performed in those two lives, it will have proper evidence that by praying to you, this miracle happened in their lives. And that's how you become a saint. Matter of fact, when John Paul, one of the most recent popes, died, very quickly he was such beloved and such a great pope in their eyes that in essence, very quickly, they were able to attribute miracles that he was able to perform from heaven. Listen, this is no disrespect to the pope, but the pope can't forgive or perform a miracle if he has already returned back to the dust from whence he came. He can perform a miracle. And this is always interesting because we get into this sometimes, that how is it that the Pope is God on earth? How is he the vicar of Christ? How is he God on earth? Yet when he dies, he can't get up. I got a problem with that, Mark. I need a God who can not just lay down his life, but can take it up again. It's interesting because they fought, and it wasn't just sola scriptura, it was also sola fide, which is faith in Jesus, was the only way to receive pardon for sins rather than works. You heard the text this morning, for by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. This is what Martin Luther stood for, because the church was teaching that somehow your works could save you. One of the greatest misconceptions in Christianity today is that somehow you can do something to be saved. There is nothing you can do that you can be saved. Understand, Jesus completed your salvation on Calvary's cross. Your job is just to accept him as a free gift from him. Oh, friends, I need you to understand today. I need you to grasp this concept that God has paid for your sins already, that he has performed the work of forgiveness on your behalf on Calvary's cross. The Reformation taught that it was on you to receive this as a free gift from God. If somebody could help me, just give me just a little water, I'd appreciate it. But I need you to understand today that this is a very special message. It is, if you would, very much a part, or if you would, in essence, it is the three angels' message in verity, that the just shall live by faith in Jesus Christ. We cannot save ourselves. Only Jesus and his shed blood can be that balm in Gilead that can wash us and make us clean. It's very interesting because Paul uses some very strong words. And I need you to understand today that you cannot make yourself clean. You cannot make yourself pure, because you just simply cannot earn your forgiveness, God's grace, or your salvation. It's a free gift. It's a free gift. Anybody attaching anything to that gift is misrepresenting Jesus Christ. It's very interesting today, friends, because Paul uses some very powerful words. Paul says, "For I am not ashamed. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ." Church, I need you to understand the gospel is the saving power of God. Salvation is not only started by God, but it is carried through by his power. It is the power of God that saves us. The gospel is the good news. It is the saving power of God. And the good news is found in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21, where the Bible says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." The good news of salvation is that Jesus came, that Jesus died, but that Jesus rose early on Sunday morning. It's important to realize that without that, there is no such thing as salvation. That without that, our living is in vain. Salvation was initiated by God. You cannot save yourself, because in and of yourself, you have no natural desire to want the things of God. You have no ability to desire God on your own. It's he that instills that grace inside of you that causes you to want him. Remember when Adam and Eve messed up in the garden, they did not go to God to ask for help. They did not go. No, rather, they went and tried to perform their own works by covering themselves with leaves. But understand, they were still guilty before God. They were still unholy before God. And they did not go looking for him. They hid from him. But in the cool of the day, in the very cool of the day, Jesus came looking for them. Our friends, you ought to rejoice today that when you were down, when you were out, when you were on the side of the road, Jesus didn't leave you there. Jesus came looking for you. Oh, we ought to rejoice today because we have a God that for some reason, as many times as we mess up, he refuses to give up on us. No matter what we have done, he loves us with an unconditional love. He continues to pour out his love toward us. It's very interesting because even in the process of salvation, even man could not interfere. God says very clearly that what I'm doing is good news. He died, he rested, and he got up with his own power. Oh, what a God we serve that could not only just lay his life down. From Calvary's cross, he declares it is finished. Into thy hands do I command my spirit, and the spirit left. But he says in John chapter 10, verse 17 and 18, no man taketh my life. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I laid down my life so that I could take it up again. I didn't lay it down in vain. No, I laid it down that humanity might be redeemed. I laid it down that sinners might come to repentance. I laid it down that those who have messed up can come back to Jesus Christ. Oh, friend, it's very interesting. It's very interesting because when we come to Jesus, it's not just forgiveness that he gives us, but the Reformation taught us that it was justification. That indeed, when we come to him and he forgives us, we become right with God. When we come to Jesus, there's sanctification, growth in his holiness. There's glorification, transformed into the likeness of Christ. We become a child of God. Becoming one requires that we, as the children of Adam, recognize that we are messed up in our present condition and we are desperately in need of a Savior. And it requires the power of God to perform a miracle in us to change us from within. The power of the gospel is to effect salvation. We must respond with faith. Faith does not earn us anything, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. You must believe that God has the power to deliver you. Oh, friends, the early reformers fought hard against the false teachings. But then we go to Paul, and Paul has to throw in there that he is not ashamed. Paul could have said, I'm proud of the gospel. But Paul says, I'm not ashamed. Paul could have said a lot of things, a lot of, you know, there's nothing like following God. It's the most glorious gospel ever. But he doesn't say that. Paul says, I am not ashamed. And I need you to understand that immediately in my mind, the question has to be asked, well, what was there to be ashamed of? That Paul felt the need to declare to the Romans, I am not ashamed. Well, some of you may have forgotten. Some of you may have left your mind. But you ought to understand that Jesus was not born in the penthouse suite. Jesus was born, Lord help us, in a lowly manger. He was wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger, lying in a feeding trough. He was born in the barn house and was laid where they feed cattle. Jesus was someone who most would not want to affiliate with because of how he looked and how much money he had. The disciples were basically sick and tired of being poor. They had heard enough about his next kingdom and said, you need to go ahead and take that kingdom now so I can sit on your right hand and the other can sit on your left. Understand that there's a lot of things about Jesus that don't necessarily make us drawn to him, because he was poor and his family was poor, and he was born, if you would, born in a barn, and in essence, when his mother and they needed rest, there was no room found for them in the inn. Friends, understand, one of the biggest problems we have today is not that we don't have any more room in the inn, but we don't have any room to let Jesus in to our hearts. We have too much other stuff going on. And understand this, that he, in essence, is buried where they have and feed the animals. He's lying in hay, man. He's lying where the horses are trying to eat. He didn't know who his daddy was. Imagine that. He's walking around. He's broke and he's poor and he's living in the ghetto, man. Nazareth was the ghetto, and this is where he's from. Yet somehow, man, he's trying to save the world. His dad is broke. His family is broke. As a carpenter, they are broke. Matter of fact, they took his birthday money to pay bills. They took the frankincense, the myrrh, and the gold, and they used that to pay for bills. He is a broke man. What is there to be ashamed of? He himself said that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have a place to lay his head. What is there to be ashamed of? He was whipped and he was beaten. They hung him up on a cross like he was a coming thief. Open shame, naked on a cross, beaten and downtrodden, but somebody here knows that it's the cross that brought us grace. It was the cross that connected heaven to earth. It was the cross that delivered us. And the early reformers understood that if Jesus did it all by himself, that there was nothing you and I could do to help him out after it was already done. Oh, friends, understand there's a whole lot to be ashamed of. But Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, and to everyone, as the song says, everyone that believeth. Oh, friends, as I close off this message today, I want to point you just to a couple of other reformers. There were a couple of, they were the preface or the precursor. They preceded the actual major dates for the Reformation. The first was John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe preached, taught, did all kinds of great writings, translations. Wycliffe Bible is still with us to this day. It's very interesting because Wycliffe dies in 1384. It's interesting because Martin Luther is just 12 years old when John Wycliffe dies. But he heard about, he studied, he understood, and he believed in the writings of Wycliffe. It's important to realize that when you die preaching the truth, there's always more people that rise up because what you have taught. You should also understand that truth is never diminished nor tarnished. Whenever somebody wants to challenge truth, understand truth only burns brighter the more you challenge it. It's almost as if the more you challenge it, the more you just brought out some silver and some polish to make it even brighter than what it was before. Truth never diminishes when it's challenged. And it's amazing because Paul brings us to this reality, but the reformers stood on these writings. Not just Paul, but in the back of this, we hear again the words, the just shall live by faith. Wycliffe's writings were widespread throughout Europe, tons of people began to believe in what he was writing. It still was not popular. The Roman Catholic Church was still persecuting those who believed in his writings. And then here comes along, if you would, not Luther, but it was John Huss that comes along right after John Wycliffe. John Huss was a bohemian reformer. He was a philosopher. He was a theologian. And John Huss got into trouble because he was bold with his, to the extent that there was a council of Constance held between 1414 and 1418. For 4 years, the Roman Catholic Church and all those associated with them had an ecumenical meeting. They called the Council of Constance between 1414 and 1418. At this time, John Huss' teachings were well known to be contradictory to the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. And so because of this, he was invited to this meeting. At this same meeting, this church meeting, they voted in a new pope. At the same church meeting, they developed other edicts to let people know of their beliefs and reaffirm what they taught. But John Huss was invited to this meeting. It's John Huss who has heard about what John Wycliffe has written, and it's John Huss that shows up. And he comes, according to them, they just wanted him to come and share his views. Just come and share your views that go against what the church teaches. It's interesting, friends, because as soon as he got there, he was arrested and thrown into prison. Indeed, it was a setup. Later on May the 6th, 1415, the second year of the council, it's very interesting because they were so angry at the teachings of Huss that they reflected on who he got it from in John Wycliffe. And at that council, 31 years after John Wycliffe had died, they declared John Wycliffe to be a heretic. They said all of his books should be burned. Take his stuff, everything you find of him, anybody associated, and burn it. As a matter of fact, 13 years after this, it was carried out. They not only burned all his books and stuff, but they actually dug up John Wycliffe. They exhumed his body. Decades after he died, they exhumed his body and they burned him. They burned his remains into ashes, spread them on the River Swift. And then, 2 months after that, understand, Huss has come before them. And it's very interesting because when they finally let Huss come and speak to the council, it is under the notion that Huss, when he comes before them, will recant his beliefs, will give them up, will say, I was wrong, will come before them and tell the whole council that I'm sorry I said these things against the Roman Catholic Church. But when Huss comes before them, Huss said, I would not, even if you gave me a whole chapel full of gold, I cannot recant on the truth that I have taught. They threw him back in jail. Threw Huss right back in jail. And like I said, on May 6, 1415, they condemn Wycliffe as a heretic. They then condemn Huss as a heretic. Then, friends, on July the 6th day of 1415, they took Huss and they declared him a heretic against the Roman Catholic Church and burned John Huss to the stake. They burned him. This is during a church meeting. They have in church. And they burned John Huss to the stake because he disagreed with their positions. They burned him, put him out there to burn. And if that was the end of the story, then all we could say is, I guess we're waiting till resurrection morning. If that was the end of the story, I guess all we could say is, he was a great martyr, great man. But that wasn't the end of Huss' story. Because somebody recorded that while Huss was burning, Lord help us, that they could hear him singing psalms until he had completely passed away. He's hanging on, he's there on the stake, he's bound to the stake, he's burning, his body is being burned alive. Huh? But he's on there singing, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Huh? More to be desired are they than fine gold. Yea, they much fine gold. He's singing, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in grief. He's singing, be still and know that I am God. He's singing, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. He's singing, God is my refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. He's singing, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. He's singing, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. While he's going down, he's going down with the same faith that he lived by. These times that are upon us, where the whole world has already been brought together. In these times, as we deal with a current pope that's calling for the whole world to come together to fight this COVID virus, as we deal with these times, soon and very soon, the instruction will be given from heaven for the four winds to let go of their winds, for the four angels to let go of their winds of strife. We ought to know that when everything hits the ceiling, that there are some songs that we can sing. Ah, when it gets bad, we can say, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness. Huh? The God of Jacob is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. But if we think for a second that somehow Jesus suffered persecution and the reformers suffered persecution and the Protestants over the ages have suffered persecution, yet somehow we're going to get to heaven without it, we have been sadly mistaken. Because the time of trouble we're about to go through, the Bible says, has never been seen before. So as you sit there by your computers, as you sit there by the TV, as you sit there watching, God is calling us, the Remnant Church of Bible Prophecy, God is calling us, a little church that insists on protesting, to protest one more time. Tell the world that we're living in the time of judgment and Jesus is soon to come. To tell the world very clearly that these are the last days. To make it very clear to the world the three angels' message. I heard another voice. I heard another voice. Tell the world that you heard another voice. Huh? Warning very clearly that there's coming a power that will seek to control the entire world. And the Bible makes it clear that the whole world
will wander after will follow the beast. This is the message that we've been given to preach. It's not popular. It's not comfortable. And let's make it clear. We don't despise or hate anyone that's a member of the Roman Catholic Church. But as a structure, as a system, they are the first beast of Revelation 13. They will join hands with the second beast of Revelation 13, the United States of America, to force every man, woman, boy, and girl to worship on the first day of the week, a day that there is no scriptural authority, a day that has not been blessed, made holy, or sanctified by God. They try to force everyone to disobey God's word and obey the devil's word, because it's the dragon, the devil himself, that gives power to the beast. So as we approach these last days, this is not time to get afraid, to get fearful, to get scared. For if God is for us, who can be against us? Oh, church family, or those of you that are watching, if you just want to say today, I'm determined to keep protesting in these last days, I invite you to stand right where you are. Stand to your feet right where you are and say, I'm going to keep on protesting. Those of you that are sitting there, get off the couch and stand for Jesus and tell him that I want to be counted in the number that will be there protesting in the end. I will stand for you even if my life is at stake. I'm standing for Jesus Christ. Your heads are bowed. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. As difficult as it is sometimes, we thank you for your word. Give us courage in these last days to stand for what's right. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Please join with us in singing the closing hymn, number 608, Faith is the Victory.
Against the foe in bells below.
wherever you are, bow your heads and close your eyes for the benediction. Dear Heavenly Father, we learned that we are to be Protestants, to protest against falsehoods, against false teachings, against conspiracy theories, strange fire. Help us, Lord, to protest against of the mark of the beast, which is Sunday worship when it is enforced by law. Help us, Lord, to fall on our knees that you might fight our battles. Help us not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as we go about our week, may the Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. To him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the throne of God, let God's people, wherever you are, say, Amen.
When we go, we Father, in my seat. But the devil is defeated.